You know, I've reserved my comments on this topic for a little bit far too long for my liking. I pride myself on my ability to keep it 100 all times under any circumstances in front of any audience. There's this movement, Black Lives Matter, that's been going on, and I haven't chimed in on it because I don't know anything about that. I'm a blonde-haired, green-eyed, white girl from New Orleans. I'll never understand what it's like to be black growing up in America. I'm not even gonna sit here and pretend because I don't live like that. I can't even begin to understand what it's like. I teach predominantly black schools, in predominantly black schools, and it hurts me that I teach young black males and I try to teach them to live outside of their circumstances and to say, you know what, it doesn't matter where you come from, you could be anything the hell you want to be, bruh. But it's very hard once they leave my classroom and then they step outside into the world and it's the complete opposite of everything that I try to teach them inside of it. And the ratio of them actually making it and the statistics against them are stacked up. It's ridiculous. It's insane. You're down bad. And up until the people of this country get together and realize the system and how this system works, you're always going to be trapped and a victim of it. That's just my opinion. I mean, take it or leave it, it is what it is. The system is messed up from top to bottom, and there's nothing that I could do. There's nothing that you could do, but together we can do a whole lot once we get it all together, once we unite as a people, not as blacks, not as whites, not as Latinos, not as Asians, not nothing. But the moment that we get together, all of us, educate ourselves and go about this the right way, I believe that we can make positive change.
In the name of my ancestors, peace and respect you. Of course, I am the mighty Angel Snubnub 7. And I would like to just take a few minutes, and I thank you so much with the honor of giving me these few minutes of your time. Right before I made my most marvelous appearance, you just listened to the comments of a young Caucasian pink lady of whom seems to be a teacher. Y'all say white. I don't like saying or making reference to Caucasian people as white because white in the English language means righteous, holy, pure, so forth. And they know, and we know, that you are not and have never been righteous, pure, holy. That is not a hateful comment on my part. That is simply the real truth. And this is something that you cannot deny. In fact, I have never known no person, regardless of race, who you can say is holy and pure and righteous, all that. And in religious circles, it says that your righteousness is as filthy rags in the sight of God. So we know you cannot be white. So I will say Caucasian or pink or Caucasian pink. Now, she is one of many thousands, if not millions, of Caucasian pink people in this nation who may consider them good, who may consider themselves just, who may consider themselves not racist, and so forth. They are not prejudiced or biased or hate-filled when it comes to the descendants of slaves born in America having dark skin. However, I want all of you who are good Caucasian people, I want you to realize something. Something that perhaps maybe your black friends really don't emphasize or tell you. She said that she, of course, is a Caucasian lady from New Orleans, and she will never know what it is to be a black person in this nation. Well, my question is, if you know that you will never know how it is to be a black person in this country, please answer me the question, why do some of you act like you do? When black people say this, you gotta say that. Whatever we say, oh, that's not impossible. You can't be suffering. You always negate. You always reject the things that we say, our grievance and our complaint. But yet it's still, I will never know what it means to be black in this nation. You don't really listen to black people unless, of course, they are saying something that favors you. Whereas Caucasian people are not being blamed for anything. If we point direction to you or blame you for something, then you buck up and you get defensive. You don't embrace the solutions that black people present to you. You want to present what you think black folks should do. Yet and still, you're not black, and you will never know what it means to be black. But yet and still, you have the solution to our problem. We are so stupid and we are so foolish that we have no idea of what to do ourselves. This goes back to that mentality that Caucasian people have been conditioned to have. You have a slave master mentality, and you think that whatever you say, black folks are supposed to listen. What is that old commercial? When such and such talks, everybody listens. That's the way black people are supposed to respond when you open your mouth, because you have a slave master mentality. Not only do black people have a problem in this nation, but you do too, because you have been conditioned to believe that you're better, smarter, and you think that you are still the slave master. She goes on to say, and it sounds so good, don't it? Coming from the mouth. How all of us supposed to get together as a nation, not as black, not as Caucasian, not as Mexicans, not as Asians, whatever. We come together as American citizens. But how long has the black man, so-called black man, these who are the descendants of slaves, prisoners of war, having dark skin, born in America, how long have we been here? Going on 500 years, not 50 years. Not 140 years, going on 500 years. And nobody is interested in what you're talking about. And probably even yourself, you're not really interested. Because if you look in this nation, everybody is looking out for themselves. The Asians are looking out for themselves. Of course, the Caucasian pink people are looking out for themselves, for what benefits them. And even in their circles, the Irish and the Germans, everybody is doing their own thing, looking out for what is in the best interest of themselves. They could care less about the children of ex-slaves. Then she goes on to say and talks about the system. Well, this one really gets me. They always talk about the system. Who created the system? Who is controlling the system? It is Caucasian pink people. That is who is controlling. They're always talking about, oh, we need to get together to fight against the large, rich families like the Rothschilds and the Vandenbergs or whoever they are. They are Caucasian people. The system was created by Caucasian people. You cannot get away from Caucasian people, but these good Caucasian pink people, they don't never want to blame and said they don't never want to blame whitey. They don't want to cross that line. Because to blame Whitey means they have to really look into themselves. And to blame Whitey means they must accept responsibility. They must make proper choices. And that is something they really don't want, because there's a benefit to doing your own thing. Who cares about the Negro, the colored, the African American, the black, whatever you want to call us? Make it on your own. That's what they tell us all the time. But when we attempt to do that, then you always get in our business trying to tell us what to do. Or you use your position in this life. You control the banks and you control the media and you control all these things to continue to hinder our progress, the good Caucasian people. So if we're having problems with the good Caucasian people, what are you expecting? What do you expect to get from those who are bad? When it's all said and done, you must blame Whitey and you must face Whitey. Even if you are Whitey, if you really mean what you're talking about, you have to cross that line. When you're ready to cross that line, then things will change, because you are the majority in this country and you have much clout. But until then, what you're saying sounds good, but it's nothing but it's empty words. I don't care about what you say. I care about what you do. And from the actions of the people in this nation, they could care less about black people and our problems. In fact, it seems you find some kind of joy that black people are in this condition. So, in the name of my ancestors, peace forever and always, and welcome to another edition of the Realities Temple on Earth Internet Ministry. I'm your host of this program, known here on what some may still call the World Wide Web. I am known as the mighty, mighty, mighty Angel Snuffed Up 7. I am your brother and hopefully your friend, Talik Ibn Ra. I want to speak to those of us who describe ourselves and make the claim, and we may be called, and we may call ourselves atheists. And atheist is simply one who does not believe in God. I want to say to you, if you are wise, and I am so happy that you've taken the first step to, what is the word I'm looking for? But to separate yourself away from religious dogma. And that is to say that you are an atheist. That's wonderful. However, if you truly have this type of mindset, then we must take this further. What do you mean by taking it further? First of all, I refuse to allow anybody to label me. Where does this word atheist come from? Every word that we use comes from somewhere, and it gets a meaning and a why. Why is there a need to have an atheist? Because you are surrounded, and we have become surrounded in a world filled with those who believe in some kind of mystery God, invisible God, some type of God. In fact, some now God has become a man and flesh, but when you see them talking how they talk, this man, this God that is supposed to be a man, still fits into the category of a mystery and invisible and all this other fictional fantasy dogma of religion. And so through religious texts comes this word atheism that is designed by those who believe in God to make mockery and demean these who dare to disbelieve in these numerous gods. There is only one God, but yet and still, you go to this corner, there are five gods, and you go to that corner, there are six gods, and there are many, many gods, but the anger comes because we don't believe and refuse to believe in at least one of the hundreds of gods that are available for us to believe in. Woo. Do not allow yourself to be labeled. I am not an atheist, but you are an atheist. And now in America, atheism is considered a religion because you acknowledge God by saying you don't believe. To not believe in God really does not mean that you don't believe. Do you understand what I'm saying? You're acknowledging that God exists. You just don't believe in God. Just like saying, I guess, you don't know whether or not I exist. You just don't believe in me and the reality's temple on earth. It's the same. You're still giving some kind of acknowledgement that this God exists. You believe. So since that's what you believe, you're not saying I know God does not exist. You say I don't believe in God. And using that word belief, you're placing yourself in the same type of category as those who believe in God, except you're saying, I don't believe in the God. So what do you suggest? What do you tell these persons who call you an atheist? Don't call me no atheist. You don't want me to call you out of your name. Don't call me out of my name. I do not acknowledge God. It's just like if I did not know what an apple was. I've never seen an apple. I don't know what it is. I have no knowledge of this apple. So I can't believe in the apple, nor can I not believe in the apple because I don't know nothing about it. These gods that you talk about, I have no idea. I don't know I can't believe or disbelieve. I have no knowledge of it. So I am simply a person who accepts my reality. However, if you can show me with clear, convincing, and overwhelming evidence that God exists, I have no choice but to accept God as a reality. This you can't do. I already know that you can't. But this also does not mean that I will serve or I will worship your God. I will respect the Creator. I will honor the Creator. Matter of fact, even in religious texts, it tells us, this God tells us, to honor thy mother and thy father, not serve and worship mother and father. So if God is telling us to do this with our parents. If God is the father, the parent, why would God want you to worship and serve him or her? And if God has all this power, how can you serve a God that can do everything? And y'all, God is magical. With the snap of a hand, some fruit juice and a pure and a sandwich. You can't do nothing for this God. So how do you? The whole thing does not make any sense. So how can you serve God? You can't do nothing for this God. And why would this God with all this power want somebody or nobody that has no power like you to serve him or her, unless this God is on an ego trip? Arrogant. See, this is where slave teachings come from. This is where, and the origin of why people view others as inferior and themselves as superior. Because I have God-like characteristics. I'm smarter than you. I'm more powerful than you. I'm like a God. And those who are inferior to me, like this God is telling you, then I am worthy of you being my slave. The difference between a servant and a slave. When you simply want to serve somebody, the benefit is that the one of whom you are serving gives you a reward. You get paid. You get a tip. There is a benefit to your servitude. But when you are serving someone and there is no benefit to you, when you serve God and there is no benefit to you, then you are a slave. Some of these people say, I am nothing without God. You are nothing without your slave master. You have found something to serve and worship. I don't understand this about black people. After over 300 years of physical slavery, you would think we would be tired and sick of wanting to serve somebody. But if it's not the racist Caucasian people that we are serving, we want to serve another black man who is divine. Some invisible being, some other kind of spirituality, as long as we can bow down and submit our will to do the will of some God. And when you talk, you don't even talk of yourself. You repeat this belief that you conjured up, that you have been sold. We don't even know who you are. So I talked to Michael. I don't know who Michael is, because Michael is basically speaking from what he believes that he did not even create. Well, the Quran said, and the Bible said, the Torah says. What do you say? Who are you? What is your life? What's the sense of being born so that you can serve and be a patsy to somebody else? I don't understand it. So what is your life? I will not serve God, because there is no life, there is no other life form that is better than me. God is not better than me. God is not better than you. And if God is the parent, then that parent wants you to be better than them. Why can't you be better than God? Yet and still you call yourself a child of God. A child has the potential to be greater and better than his or her parent. It is natural not to believe in some God. If it was natural, you would not have to teach me about God. And since it is natural not to believe in some God, there is no word for disbelief. There's no description. There's no label. There's no need for it. I have not interacted with this God. I cannot. So how can I believe or disbelieve? I have never met, nor have you. All this is pretend interaction with some being. And if you pretend enough, your brain, since you're not doing anything better with your brain, it will make you feel and have some type of interaction, but it's not real. Just like the drunk who interacts with a pink elephant. The pink elephant is not real, and your God is not real. I don't care what you say, you cannot prove it, and you can talk to you blue in the face. You will not win that argument. That's why you must believe. If it was a fact, then you would know. But it's not a fact. That's why you must believe. And a belief does not require proof. It does not require logic, reasoning, or common sense. In the name of my ancestors, peace forever and always, and welcome to another edition of the Realities Temple on Earth Internet Ministry. I am the host of this particular program, known here on the internet as the Mighty, Mighty, Mighty Angel Snubnub 7. I'm your brother, and hopefully your friend, Talik Ibn Rabah. I want to speak about this business or this fiasco of Brother Polite being a ripoff artist, scamming black people in this so-called black conscious community. Those of us who are seeking what some may call black liberation. It is not up for me, or it is not up to me. How do you say that grammatically correct? It's not my desire to judge Brother Polite, condemn Brother Polite, and I wish to be fair and honest and just towards Brother Polite. However, he does not do a very good job of justification and explaining the recent actions compared to the evidence and those things said by persons who allege that he did rip them off or scam them. And I want to say to us very quickly, when you are ripped off and when we are scammed, I don't want us to feel shame, because it is easy to get caught up in a ripoff. It is easy to get caught up in a scam. However, we as a people, this sort of thing, and y'all claim to read all these books and know so much black history and you know so much, but you cannot recognize a lie. You cannot recognize a scam. A scam or a lie. It feeds your emotion, so it's acceptable. Otherwise, you could not be a victim of a scam. You could not be a victim of a lie. It has to be something that you find pleasing. You will not allow me to scam you because what I say you don't like. It does not feed your emotion. I speak reality. And you don't want to hear reality. You want to hear some type of fantastic, fictional thing that will feed your emotion. So you will listen to a pastor in a church. You will listen to a minister in a mosque. You will listen to Brother Polite because they are teaching you something that feeds your ego, your self-righteousness. Just like getting high on a drug, it takes you out of reality. And that's what most of you don't want. You don't want to accept and face your reality. Now, I had a desire about 10 or 12 years ago. It was a strong desire to be an entertainer. I wanted to be on the level of a Michael Jackson, MC Hammer, and people like that. I just wanted to do that. So I met a person who seemed as though they could help me get where I want to go. And I put my faith in him. Did you hear what I said? I put my faith in him. You put your faith in Brother Polite because he's giving you something that you want. He's feeding your desire to be this painting, this image of this blackness that you have in your mind. And so, to make a long story short, because I don't have enough time to really get into what happened, but I knew as time went on, this person was charismatic, and this person interacted with people like Patti LaBelle. And this person had interaction with major labels. In fact, he did get a record deal. And I thought I was going to be part of it because from the very beginning, I was part of his rise to the top. But when he rose to the top, he had no intent to take me with him. So when Polite, as he rise to the top, who is he taking with him? And in the interim, I was giving my time, giving my money, trying to get us to where we need to go. So I have seen the likes and the same type of talk of a Brother Polite. I've seen that before. But our problem is we get caught up in our emotion and our desire. So if you desire to be a singer, if you have this strong desire to be a model, if you have this strong desire to be a big-time baseball player, whatever your desire, there's somebody out there who will see that you have this strong desire and they will take advantage of it and exploit you. Give me $500, I can make you a famous model. Give me $1,000, I can help you get signed to Motown Records. Give me $1,000, give me $1,500, and I will correct your status. And you will be a different kind of American or whatever. We know history, so you say, but we don't apply it to what we know. And so when you look at somebody like Brother Polite, and I say that very lightly, I'm just saying that just to describe Polite, because if his behaviors does not show that he's really too much of a brother to us, taking this, the allegations lightly, and the community looking, and he don't really care, because I got mine. I got enough out of you suckers. So I will take pictures with these pink Caucasian celebrities, because that's all that I want to begin with. That's really what this, that's really where he comes from. You saw him with somebody like a comedian like Paul Mooney and all these guys like that, because that's where he really wants to be. And he found a clique. He found something in this black community. And because we are emotional, we fail for the smart talker, the one who can feed our emotion. In fact, the House of Consciousness itself, Sarnetta said, it's entertainment or edutainment, but it's entertainment. When did black hurt? When did black pain? When did the death of Marcus and Malcolm and the suffering of our people become entertainment? Please tell me, show me how you can make that entertaining. There's nothing entertaining about a person ripping you off for the dollars that you work hard for. What's entertaining about that? So Sarnetta sits back in the cut. And y'all, because you have this desire, they feed your emotion. That's all you're going to get, is feeding your emotion. Sarnetta gets a brother and another brother. And he gets on a megaphone and welcomes the people to a debate. Put these brothers in a ring. And just like they do on wrestling, let's get ready to rumble. Who you gonna rumble against? I'm gonna rumble against another brother. I'm not going in the ring with a KKK member. I'm not going in the ring with somebody from the Nazi party or some Caucasian person who is anti-reparations and anti-anything that benefits black people. You putting a brother in the ring against another brother who basically want the same thing. Wow. So you have a desire, and there's nothing wrong with your desire. However, you're being emotional. Emotion causes us not to think. Our emotion causes us not to be wise. And you know in your heart that you are being scammed. And there are two ways of being scammed. There are those who scam you on purpose, and then there are those who may have good intent that you get scammed. Look how your leader is living. The fancy cars. They don't have to worry about health care. In fact, you take care of them. They don't work, but look at you. And these same leaders would talk to you about freedom, justice, and equality. Where is the equality when Your leadership is living high on the hog, but the average member is barely able to make it. Where is the equality? But your emotion and your desire for a black nation, your love and desire for this, for being independent from racism and all this wrapped up inside of you. You want this so bad that you overlook this reality. And we really need to stop doing this, because not only does it affect us as an individual, but it is going to affect your babies and your children. And y'all having a whole lot of children. And what are you going to leave behind? What type of legacy are you going to give your children? You're not going to leave them and give them nothing. Because following a scam artist, whether that scam artist has ill intent or good intent, is going to leave you with nothing. So with that said, you ignore those who could truly help us in what needs to be done. But they don't feed your emotion. You're caught up in fantasy. I was caught up in fantasy when I was with this guy. And in my mind, I was already on the level of a Michael Jackson. And that's where you are. I was living in fantasy, and that's where you are right now. So in the name of my ancestors, peace forever and always, and welcome to another edition of the Realities Temple on Earth Internet Ministry. Of course, I am the host or the gatekeeper of this particular program, known here on social media as the Mighty, 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 Angel Snutting Up 7. I am your brother and hopefully your friend, Talik Ibn Ra. Wow, this subject, I thought that I would never have to do or speak on this topic, but it has been troubling me, and there must be an answer. And from my position, I always look to nature to give me my answer to the problem that I seek. I also rely on my brain. And being a self-thinking person, I have to think things out, not based on emotion, not based in what somebody is selling on a television or a radio or on social media, but what is in the best interest of myself. And as an advisor to these who are the descendants of slaves born in America, put myself in a position to give us the best advice. Now, of course, we have our opinion, but what is the best opinion? And hopefully within the next 10 minutes, we can come to an appropriate balance in that opinion, as there is no right or wrong. However, there is a consequence for the choice that we make, regardless to whether it is correct or incorrect. The result or the response or the consequence in the end will tell you or give us the answer or the verdict to the problem, conclusion to the opinion that we decided to choose. Now, my subject is, should the American people or any people, the citizens outside of the military, should we be allowed or should we have guns? Is it necessary to have guns? What is very clear is that we have the right of self-defense. All of us who live, even in the animal kingdom, all of us have the right to self-defense so that we may be able to counter that which is trying to bring us harm and protect our life. I want to begin with a little history in America, bringing or raising a question in the, or what is called the Wild Wild West. Remember, in the Wild Wild West, everybody could carry a gun. There was no law. As America gotten territory and everybody began to head west, and as they began to settle the west, there was no law. That's why you could rob somebody in New York City and run west so that you can go outside of the law, thus the term outlaw. Now, in the Wild Wild West, everybody could carry a gun. It was very important to have a gun to defend yourself, and you also used the weapon to secure food. Now, this is what I want us to ask ourselves about the Wild Wild West in comparison to what is going on in our modern time. Now, you can teach me by showing me any report that you know of, any finding that was reported in the history of the Wild Wild West, where somebody went into a saloon or a hotel or wherever people gathered, and there was mass killings like we see today. I don't know. I'm pretty sure you had people that would go into a saloon or these places, even a church where people gathered, and I'm pretty sure they would shoot the place up. However, since everybody was carrying a weapon, I don't think that was a popular idea, and I don't think that those who decided to commit such an atrocity, you do not have to worry about a court of law. The people that had guns took care of that business. Nobody's carrying a gun is going to allow some sucker to come among them and get to shooting, and you have a gun yourself, and there are guns everywhere, and those who have these weapons don't take this idiot out. You have a right to self-defense. But in America, you can't have a gun. They don't want you to have a gun like that. So I can be a pissed off, spoiled brat and get angry at the world, and I can go to my local movie theater and just get to blasting, and I don't have to worry about somebody blasting me back. I can just have a good time. Somebody would have to actually risk their life trying to jump you and try to unarm you and things of this nature. That should not be necessary. So in our modern times, countless innocent, unarmed people have been shot down. But what if those people, once the shooting began, they had a weapon where they could shoot back? In situations like that, innocent people will still be hurt because you're trying to counter where this fire is coming from. But yet and still, like I said, those who think that way, if they knew that they were going in a situation where almost immediately, as soon as they get to popping off, they would get killed, their thinking would be different. However, when someone turns insane in the mind, there's nothing that can be done about that. In nature, you have animals that grow horns. They have fangs. The animals have poison. They have a strong leg and can give you a swift kick. Animals defend themselves. Animals like rabbits have no defense, so they are easily used as prey. And the animal that targets them as prey, they know that there is no consequence. But if you want to attack a bear or a rattlesnake or some animal with horns, there might be a consequence. You can kill the bear, you can kill the rattlesnake, but they have some kind of defense and you have to be careful. It's not easy. And that's what it's about. Not making it easy to be prey for somebody. In America, in this Constitution, the forefathers wrote that the citizens have the right to bear arms and to form a militia. Why? Just in case the government becomes corrupt. Who is more corrupt than the government that we are living under right now, that have all the citizens at each other's throat, taking your money and squandering your taxes, causing endless war, causing you enemies and all over the world? For what? How is the American people really benefiting from this? And so they are seeking to disarm you and don't want to give you, allow you to have the weapons that the military have. So if there is a conflict, it is easier for them to come in and cause you harm. And that's what it's all about. Making it easy so you can't defend yourself against corruption. I remember I was driving an ice cream truck and I was robbed by this person. And at the time, I was taught against owning a gun. However, what if I had had a weapon to defend myself? Do you know how it feels to be so helpless? You don't have nothing, and this sucker got a gun or a knife or something in your face. They don't want you to have a gun. They don't want you to have weapons on you so you can defend yourself against rogue cops and silly people like George Zimmerman. What if young Trayvon Martin had a gun? The only reason why Trayvon Martin is dead is because he could not defend himself. He had no kind of weapon, a knife or gun or anything. And this maniac easily took his life. And that's what it is. That's why they don't want you to have a way to defend yourself so it can be easy for them to do whatever they want to us. And so the conclusion, the only conclusion that I can come up with is that you and I have the right to defend ourselves. And we should not allow some sucker to tell you you can't have your gun, your knife, and your weapon when you are living in an environment with all these fools, including your government, your senators, your congresspeople, your representatives, even your president, who is dropping bombs on others all over the earth. And they do this because they know that the people of whom they are dropping these bombs upon, they are limited and don't have the kind of weapons they have. So I want to take the weapons away from Iran. I don't want Iran or North Korea to have nuclear capability. So when I make my move, I can destroy them at my leisure. They want to take you out at their leisure. So I cannot sit back and tell somebody, oh, we should not have guns. You out in the street and some gangbangers want to act silly and crazy, and we can't defend ourselves at all.